Good morning, everybody. Very warm welcome. Great to see everybody. Those who've been here, I wonder how many is the longest number of, the most number of times somebody's ever been to our church. So if you're here the first time, fantastic. If you're here for the 1,000th, 2,000th, 3,000th, I don't know. Welcome to. It's great to be able to join together in worship. As we start, what I want to do first of all is just pray for Luke. Dave and Susie's son Luke has had an operation to remove fluid and a malfunctioning shunt in his brain, and he had to go to Bristol by ambulance. So if we can pray for Luke as we begin, I think that would be a good thing. And for Dave and Susie as well, of course, and John and Jackie. So is that okay with everybody? Yeah. Father, we do pray for Luke this morning, for your healing touch, for great wisdom and skill for all of the medical team, and for grace and peace and strength for Dave and Susie and all the family. We thank you for them. Ask, dear Lord, for your enormous power to be at work, bringing healing, bringing strength, bringing peace, and that sense of being held in your hands. In Jesus' name, amen. And we're going to start by singing, "The King of Love is My Delight." Let's stand.
Love is all.
Father, thank you that you sent your Son Jesus proclaiming good news that the kingdom of God has drawn near. Repent and believe the good news. And thank you that in the good news there is love for us and there is healing, and there is healing for troubled minds. So, Lord, we pray as we meet together, come by your Spirit to bring your renewing love to each one of us, all in our own different places, different things in our hearts. Come, Lord Jesus. Some words from our welcome part of the service. Come near to God, and he will come close to you. Jesus said, come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy,
and my burden is light.
Be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come in and eat with that person and they with me. Please sit or kneel as we continue our prayers. Together, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Words that express together that sense that we know as human beings we fall short of all that God has asked us to do. So we say together, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. And Father, thank you that it is with wonder and joy that we receive this precious gift of forgiveness. Thank you that you sent Jesus to die on the cross for us. And that in his death there is forgiveness for all. Send your Spirit to reassure us that we are indeed forgiven children. And help us again, we pray, to lead, to live, to walk in a newness of life. In Jesus' name, amen. And we continue in our worship. We've had three songs together. And we do it as we trust, as we worship God. He draws close to us and we draw close to him. And we pray that he speaks into our hearts and minds hope that comes from him. So let's sing, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Change. Goodness of mercy.
Days of darkness still come o'er me, sorrow's paths I often tread, but the Saviour still is with me. By his hand I'm safely led. If the sorrow is too much for you this morning, God is still with you. And a prayer for you that God will draw close to your heart and bring peace. Thank you, Lord, that we come and we can sing these songs of praise because your love is reaching out to us. Thank you that you are here with us, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, that you know each one of us by name. And you, called the man of sorrows acquainted with grief, are also the one who can bring hope and everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen. Do please take a seat. Now, all sorts of things varied really this morning. So, you may have noticed Lent has started. And I just had a thought about this. I'm actually quite excited. I think Lent is going to be a great time for people. Aren't you encouraged?
Yes.
I mean, sometimes my head works. I heard a phrase in the week, and I have to confess I own up to this. Sometimes my head is a bit like every silver lining has a cloud. But Lent will be a great thing. And the thing is, Lent is traditionally time for repentance. Purple, did you know? Purple is the sign of repentance. But the point of repentance is not to hammer you down, but to bring you close to God and build you up. That's the point. But also, one of the great ways of coming to true repentance is by getting a bigger vision of how wonderful God is. Because it's God's kindness that leads us to repentance. So it's not about being miserable. It's about preparing to know more and more of the power of God in our lives. And here's a thought. There's all sorts of things you can do to keep Lent this year. And I should tell you, there's no Bible command to do Lent. So you can ignore everything I'm saying now. You're perfectly free to. Sometimes human beings are such strange creatures that they need an excuse to do what they really want to do. Do you recognize that? Yeah. Yeah, so you could join an extra prayer meeting, Wednesdays, Saturdays. You could join our Lent course, which is looking at healing. But the point about looking at healing is you've got to look at the power of God and his kingdom, not ourselves. So that is good for us. And we did, and yeah, so that's Tuesday evening in church, also Zoomed, but also Thursday afternoon. It's great opportunities. Or, at great personal expense, and from others as well, there are a host of books at the back on your way out that you could take with you for absolute free. I'm tempted to tell you that there's a £10 note hidden in some of them, but that would be a lie. But, you know, I know not everybody likes reading, so that's fine. But if you are a reader, if you like reading, then why not take one of the books and have a look? The thing is, the Bible, you have to like eventually, right? These books, you do not have to agree with or like, but they will at least stir something up. And it's great to make that extra point of contact with trying to grow in faith, which is what Lent is all about. So there's loads of them, all sorts of things. If you want something really deep theological with small print that you have to think about and strain your eyes, there's those. But there's also more informal things as well. So have a look at those. And, yeah. That's it for me, for the time being. Except Lewis has something to say.
Hello, good morning. This is a bit of a difficult announcement for me to make, really. Having had discussion with Stephen and praying about it, I've decided to finish in my role as church school link worker here. It's with a lot of sadness because I still really enjoy the work I'm doing, but God really spoke to me and told me it was time to move on and seek some new and fresh challenges. I don't really know what those challenges are yet. So it's a bit of a scary time for me. So please keep me in your prayers and watch this space. But you may also remember a few weeks ago, I got up and I told you a bit about our young people and that we were just at the beginning of this journey with them. And Tim's going to get up in a minute, and I think he's going to share a short thing that God's been speaking to him about. But I want to encourage you, you know, pray for me, please, but pray for our young people, like, because they need it. We had a situation this Friday where we were dealing with a phone issue where kids were on their phones and they were not using them appropriately. And people say that this generation is the most connected generation in the world, but actually, human connection, they are the most disconnected generation. And to have actual human connection for them would change their lives. And then if you just think about how connection with God would change their lives even further, like, I really want to, I don't know, I want to throw down a gauntlet, really. I want to challenge you to invest in your young people because they're the future. So that's me. I don't know if Tim wants to go up and...
Well, actually, before Tim does, we'll pray for... actually, Tim, you can pray for him as well.
Thank you.
Father, we do thank you for Lewis, and we thank you that because he's heard your voice, he wants to be obedient. And that's a great thing. And we pray with thank you, Lord, for all he's done here and all he is. Thank you that you are with him. And we pray for your blessing on these next steps. In Jesus' name, amen.
As Lewis waits on God, we pray that you will speak to him clearly. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lewis. Thank you.
75% of people who have faith had faith by the time they were 18. So we have about 32 youngsters who come on a Friday evening, and if they are precious commodities. I had a dream at 4:30 on Saturday morning. My wife was out. She was away for a couple of days. So after the dream, I was able to write it down. The dream was this. There was the sea coming in to the seashore. You get those sort of fingers of waves coming in over the sand. And I could see the pebbles, you know, on the beach. And children were paddling in the sea. And I'd been thinking about the Holy Spirit and young people. Holy Spirit, God, you know, sort of. And young people. And I imagine the sea to be God's presence or the Holy Spirit coming in. And the children were paddling in the sea. And they were discovering God, the one who's protector and carer. Father isn't always a good word to use with children. It's a confusing word. But God the Father, the protector, the carer. Jesus, their friend. And God's presence. You know, sort of, you know, he's sort of there with you, the Holy Spirit. And they were discovering this as they paddled in the sea. The sea came in more, and their children were getting wet. And I thought about the way in which they were immersed or getting immersed in water. Water was all over them. And what it was to be immersed by God. And I sort of put my hand on my eyes and said, well, God use my sight, you know, give me vision, you know. Put my hand on my ears, God, speak to me, you know. Put my hand on my mouth, God, speak through me. On my body, God strengthen me, etc. And God permeating the life of these children. Not being taught that Jesus is the Saviour and God saved you. And it's just head knowledge, but actually experiencing it for themselves. And out of that experience, taking that touch of God with them. And it goes on. So obviously the sea was coming in and the children were beginning to swim. And I thought of them swimming with the presence of God with them. going in God's directions as God went with them. Now, the finale was very interesting because I thought about the waves coming in and breaking. And I had a picture of surfing on the waves. And whoever it was who was surfing on the waves, riding the waves and coming in. But the interesting thing of this picture was that over the figures riding the waves were indications of speech. And they were praising God and singing and enjoying riding on the waves of God coming upon them. I wanted to share it with you. It might be helpful. Thank you.
Thanks, Tim. Father, I pray that we will see the fruit of that dream. That if you're putting, Lord, we believe you are putting hope in our minds. And we thank you for this dream that Tim has shared and pray for your power to be at work mightily amongst our young people. And it occurs to me that we may learn afresh enthusiasm and joy and flowing in the Spirit from them. In Jesus' name, amen. Great. Well, thank you, Tim. Thanks for sharing. I do pray about all of that. That's lots to pray about. Oh, Helen has put her hand up.
Just to say, we actually had 7 children to the toddlers on Friday, several new members, so our prayers are being answered. So if we can keep praying for them, it'll build us up. And thank you for everybody who's volunteering. It's a major thing to volunteer. It's a big thing. It's taking that time out of each day to think, I've got to go and do that. But it helps so many people that we don't realise. That one little bit of word that you say to them could be just enough for them to follow and turn up into church. So just keep it going.
Now then, we are in uncharted territory when people stand up and say things I don't know are going to happen, which is brilliant. But just reminds me that just in terms of how God speaks and then it can come into fruition later, Helen had a dream once about the tiny quiet people making a noise. Helen would never get up and speak a few years back, but there is a transformation. So Helen, thank you very much indeed for braving that long journey down the aisle. We're going to sing together again this great transformation that God brings. King of Kings, in the darkness you were waiting. Let's stand to sing.
Praise the Son. Praise the Spirit.
We know that Jesus came not just for this group of people here, though he did come for us, but also for our world. And just as we stand, or as in a moment of prayer, just pray in this time for our world and its places of turmoil and conflict and warfare, for peace. How can we not think of Ukraine and a year of war? And of the conflicts between China and the United States and NATO. Lord, we cry out to you for peace. Words from our Working It Out section. We have this treasure. We have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, struck down. May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage our hearts and strengthen us in every good deed and word. Amen. Please do take a seat. It's time for our two Bible readings.
The first reading this morning is from Genesis 22, verses 1 to 19. Abraham tested. Sometime later, God tested Abraham. He said to him, "Abraham, here I am," he replied. Then God said, "Take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains I will tell you about." Early the next morning, Abraham got up and saddled his donkey. He took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. When he had cut enough wood for the burnt offerings, he set out for the place God had told him about. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. He said to his servants, "Stay here with the donkeys while I and the boy go over there. We will worship and then we will come back to you." Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and placed it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. As the two of them went on together, Isaac spoke up and said to his father, "Abraham, father." "Yes, my son," Abraham replied. "The fire and wood are here," Isaac said, "but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham answered, "God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son." And the two of them went on together. When they reached the place God had told him about, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then he reached out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called out to him from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham." "Here I am," he replied. "Do not lay a hand on the boy," he said. "Do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God, because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son." Abraham looked up, and there in the thicket he saw a ram caught by its thorns. He went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide." And to this day it is said, "On the mountain of the Lord it will be provided." The angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time and said, "I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take the possessions of the cities of the enemies, and through your offsprings all the nations on earth will be blessed, because you have obeyed me." Then Abraham returned to his servants And they set off for Beersheba, and Abram stayed in Beersheba. This is the word of the Lord.
Second reading is from Hebrews chapter 11, verses 13 to 19. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance. And they admitted that they were aliens and strangers on earth. People who say such things, that they are looking for a country of their own, if they'd been thinking of the country they'd left, they would have had opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. By faith, Abraham, when God tested him, offered Isaac as a sacrifice. He who had received the promises was about to sacrifice his one and only son, even though God had said to him, "It is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned." Abraham reasoned that God could raise the dead, and figuratively speaking, he did receive Isaac back from death. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Father, thank you for the scriptures that you've inspired for us, and we pray that we can learn from them. I ask that you help me, by your Spirit, to speak faithfully, and that to all of us, you open our eyes to see your hand, your purposes in our lives and in our world around us. Come, Holy Spirit, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we've been looking at this letter to the Hebrews, and just some of it anyway, in chapter 11. And the writer is deliberately choosing some Old Testament characters to try and encourage people who are facing difficult times and particularly persecution around the corner. And one of the questions is, why does he use these particular characters? What do we learn from them? What is God saying to us through these examples? And I have sort of an introduction to this week's topic, which is, if he's trying to encourage people, why does he choose a story of God testing one of his people? I mean, and you know, some of you will already know how I will answer that. And it's one of these things, isn't it, that if you know in advance that there will be testing times for you, and brothers and sisters, oh yes, there will, because I like to encourage you. If you know there will be testing times, it helps prepare you. If you are under the impression that following Jesus will be easy peasy, lemon squeezy, then when the difficult times come, you'll get doubtful and cynical. Doubtful because you'll start to think, does God really love me if he's letting these horrible things happen to me? And cynical because you take the line, well, if I don't believe in anything, I can't get disappointed. Ever done that? No, of course not. None of us do things like that. And so, if you, I don't think you're ever going to get to, well, no, maybe you will, maybe you're all far holier than I will ever be, which won't, yeah. But you, I don't think it's easy to get to a point where when trials come and difficulties come, you say, oh, yippee, it's a trial, I'll get better, I'll get stronger through this. But at least if you know about it, you've got a fighting chance. And here's a thought, really, that how you handle, and if you can handle trials, difficulties, obstacles well, that's the difference between giving up and growing. And so that's why he talks about this really, really unfathomably difficult moment in the Bible, and this dreadful test that God puts Abraham to. And remember the story. But we need to know that sometimes, you know, we will be tested, our faith will be tested, and that happens to everybody. So if you feel under test at the moment, you're not odd. And the reason I repeat this often enough is because people only really hear the bit of the sermon they're interested in. And so this week there will have been somebody thinking, does God really love me? If he really loves me, would I be going through this? And he does love you. He really does love you. And he'll give you strength. Though it might not feel like that every moment. So Abraham's test was this, that Abraham has been promised by God that he will have a son, and through that son, and his descendants and their descendants and their descendants, the world will be blessed, so that through Abraham and his family, the world will be blessed, and that the child who is going to bring that blessing at the next stage is Isaac, who is described as his one and only son, which is not physically speaking true, if you know your story. There's another son, and there are more to come later. But it's through Isaac that the promise is to come. And this is a miracle indeed, because it says very impolitely that he's as good as dead. He's so old, and his wife too, but they have this miracle child, a child of promise. And through Isaac is going to come the blessing to the world and the whole history of the Jewish nation, and then faith into the church. And then Abraham hears God calling his name again, Abraham, Abraham. And he says, here I am. And he says, take your son, your only son, whom you love, and sacrifice him on the mountain I will show you. Now, I can't imagine what it's like to hear those words. Can you? And the thing is, I think, just because there's a problem here, isn't there? If any of you hear God saying that to you today, we would say, that is against the scripture, that's not God. Wouldn't we? Because you're not going to do that. And many of the scholars say this actually signals in the Old Testament the fact that child sacrifice, which some people were doing to please their gods, because they hadn't learned yet, this signals the end of child sacrifice. But nonetheless, Abraham hears this really dreadful command. And Isaac is not only the son he loves, but he's also the one through whom God's promise will be fulfilled. Miracle child with the blessing to come. So it's a really difficult thing. And a real test. And then Abraham decides he will obey. He is so sure that he's heard the voice of God. And you can tell this because when Abraham is told to leave Ur, and God says, you're going to go, and then I'll show you where you're going. This is exactly what he says here. You're going to go to the mountain, and I'll show it to you when you get there. So it's the voice of God that Abraham recognizes speaking to him, and then he will obey. And he takes Isaac and the servant and donkey, and he takes the wood. And it gets to the point where Isaac says, but I can see the wood and I can see the fire, but where's the sacrifice? Where's the lamb for sacrifice? And Abraham says, God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son. And then, just as he lifts the knife to carry out what he has heard God say, then he hears a voice from heaven saying, do not lift a finger, do not sacrifice the child. I know now that you trust him. And he sees in a thicket a ram that is caught, and he knows that God has provided the lamb for the sacrifice. And God says, I now know that I can trust you. You trust me. You will be obedient. And confirms the promise of the blessing that will come through Isaac. And I think there are, for modern readers, there are all sorts of questions, aren't there? Because it seems such a strange thing. But the reason why I say with some confidence that this is, most stories in the Bible, they think they're good. They set you an example. The example here is not to take your child onto a mountain with wood and fire. The example is to hear what God is saying and do it. But this is a unique moment. And what backs up the idea that this is a unique moment is the whole of the Old Testament, New Testament story of what the heart of God is like. Because in the story, I haven't read it all out again, did you notice that it's on the third day that Abraham sets out? Have you heard anything about the third day before in Christian tradition and history in the Bible? On the third day, Jesus was raised. It talks about the Son whom you love. Now, you love this when I do this, don't you? But did you know that the word that is used here in the Greek translation of the Hebrew Bible is monogenes? And who is Jesus in John 3, John chapter 1? The only Son of God is John, monogenes. It's the same word. The only beloved Son is who is being sacrificed. And then the phrase, the Lamb of God. Have you heard that phrase before? God will provide a lamb for the sacrifice. And it's like this heaven being opened moment where Abraham, 4,000 years ago, 2,000 years before Jesus, has this prophetic insight, I believe, this astonishing trust in God who will provide the sacrifice that is needed. And that's a unique moment, isn't it, really? And this is indeed what God does, doesn't it? He provides a sacrifice, Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, God's sacrifice so that we can be forgiven. So even in the Old Testament, there is the hint, the prophecy of the gospel, of the gospel message, that God loves us so much that he sent his only Son, Jesus Christ. Whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. That you are loved. That yes, we have all gone wrong and fallen short of God's ways for us, but the punishment that that deserves, the penalty that that deserves, has been paid by Jesus on the cross. So by putting our trust and faith in him, we are set free, forgiven, and healing can come in our direction. This is a summary of the good news, a unique moment. And what the writer to the Hebrews sees in this is that there is, in Abraham's life, complete obedience. And he knows there's a bit of an issue going on because he says Abraham had reasoned about this. And what was Abraham's reasoning to be able to carry out or even get ready to do this dreadful sacrifice? It's that he knew that somehow God could bring back Isaac from the dead. Logic is this, I think. God has promised that through Isaac, the world will be blessed and through all of his descendants. God has promised this. God is now saying you must sacrifice this son. Therefore, God must be able to do something about it. Otherwise, his first promise is fallen. And God's promises don't fall. They must be kept. In a way, Abraham believes that God can bring Isaac back from the dead. And the writer to the Hebrews says, and in a sense, this is what God did. So it does feel a bit complicated. But in the end, what the writer to the Hebrews can say is that he sees God's resurrection power everywhere. Therefore, there has to be hope. The people he's writing to face persecution. Should they have hope or should they give up? Silly question. They should have hope because Jesus is raised from the dead. And if Abraham could reason that there was resurrection 2,000 years before, so how much more should people who have seen that Jesus was crucified but raised from the dead have hope now that God can act and bring new life? And, you know, just on the issue for our own church, for example, can we have hope for the future? Are we getting all old and decrepit? Or is God doing something new? And do you believe God can do something new? Because if Jesus is raised from the dead, the writer of the Hebrews sees resurrection even in the story of Abraham and Isaac. And again, I think the thing about Abraham that comes out is that he was old. He was too old to have children, and his wife was too old to have children. But God did the thing, did the miracle. And when you look with your eyes sometimes, are you good at this? When you look with your eyes, all you can see is problems. Anyone ever do that? Yes, you do. But you have to look with the eyes of faith. Put on new glasses. When the writer of the Hebrews reads these Old Testament stories, he sees it all through Jesus Christ, who died and rose again. So when we think sometimes it's difficult to pray, and it is. Sometimes, isn't it? You sit down to pray and then you think about the washing or the work or the grandchildren or something. But you say, like Abraham, here I am. You think of the problems that face you. But Jesus is alive and raised from the dead. Here I am. You think of worries and uncertainties. But then, like Abraham, here I am. Finances. Here I am. Time. Here I am. Lord, how do you want me to live? Here I am. Forgiveness. Forgiving other people. Here I am. I just made a note. I don't know if this has got anything to do with the sermon or not, really, but I'll say it anyway now. You know, sometimes you could think, who are we to think that God loves us? Who are we to pray big prayers? Who are we to trust that God can do miracles? And the answer is, the Bible tells us we are simply by having a repentant heart and trusting in Jesus, believing that he was raised from the dead. We are adopted children of a heavenly king. And the power of the resurrection, the power that raised Jesus from the dead, is at work in you and me. And so, Abraham was tested. You will be tested. But the power of God is at work to bring glory to his name. How will you respond to testing when it comes? How will you respond to challenges? Do it with faith and trust that God can help you through. Let's pray. Lord, here we are before you, each one of us so different, and yet each one loved by you. Each one facing different things, yet each one loved by you. We, dear Lord, ask for grace to be able to put our lives in your hands and to say, here I am. And whatever trial we face, to do it with faith. Open our eyes, dear Lord, to see your presence, to know your touch. In Jesus' name. Amen. And here's a song of faith and trust. Now, the Lord's my shepherd. Let's sing together. There may be a prayer you would like to share, or a Bible verse, or a picture. Do feel free to share that, and we can say amen. Thank you. I have a hunch that one or two people might be desperate for somebody to pray with them, a sort of burning feeling inside that they'd like someone to just lay a hand on their shoulder and pray. So at the end of our time, if you want to come up to the front, that'd be really good. And Tim doesn't know yet, but he'll be here to pray for you. So. The Apostles' Creed, through the centuries, unifying Christians. Let's whisper this together in faith. I believe in God, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our final song, and then there are refreshments at the back as well. Amazing Grace.
I once was lost, but now
Thanks to everyone here for joining us and everyone on the internet as well. And a final prayer. May the God of peace, who brought back the Lord Jesus from the dead and seated him on high in glory, may this same God give to you grace and peace and hope and love. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us now and always. Amen.